Oh, Hazel, that old diary of yours is terrific.
I've forgotten so many things. Read some more, Hazel.
Dear diary, remember I told you about this new boyfriend Missy's been dating once in a while? Well, he was here this evening listening to records, and I had a chance to give him the once-over. Frankly, I ain't too impressed. I told him a swell joke, and he didn't even get it. His favorite saying is hot zing.
Oh, if he's typical of your suitors, no wonder you proposed to me the minute you set eyes on me.
And when he cracks his knuckles, it sounds like firecrackers. He cracks them a lot.
Go on, Hazel, go on.
Well, no, I don't think I ought to, Mr. B.
Well, who's boss around here?
You are.
Well, then go on.
Well, if you insist, then you better read it.
He cracks his knuckles like firecrackers. He cracks them a lot. And when he crosses his eyes, he expects everyone to fall down laughing. I think we can scratch George Baxter off our list.
But Miss Johnson's so proud of her grandnephew, she could bust.
Mrs. Johnson isn't the only one. Angela and David named him after me.
Oh, ain't that nice.
You know, he's the first baby in our family for over 20 years.
It's a pretty big responsibility. I had to take out life insurance.
Oh, sure, it's a big responsibility. But there ain't nothing so wonderful as a helpless little baby that needs your care.
I feel pretty good when I give him his 2 a.m. bottle.
Davy's always taken the 2 a.m. feeding so I could get a good night's rest.
And the song I always sing to him is the Princeton fight song.
David's very loyal to his alma mater.
How many children do you have, Hazel?
Oh, I don't have none, honey. Not of my own. But I was the oldest, so I took care of my sisters and brothers and then Missy, and now I'm helping out with Harold.
You're doing a splendid job, Hazel. Splendid.
Oh, thanks, Mr. Johnson.
He's through with his bottle, Hazel. Would you like to hold him?
Would I? That's like asking a kid if he'd like a rock candy mountain. Oh, there ain't nothing so wonderful as a baby.
Herbert, that was a telephone call from Miss Simmons.
Simmons? Do we know her, Miss Simmons?
You remember, she's the nurse we hired to help us with little Herbert while the children are on vacation.
Oh, yes.
The only trouble now is she's been detained and can't get here till late this afternoon.
Oh, well, don't you worry about that, Miss Johnson. I got an easy day over at the Baxters, and I'll be glad to take care of things.
Knock, knock.
Who's there?
By George.
By George who?
By George, will you feel neglected if I play poker tonight?
Oh, not at all.
Not at all?
Well, not enough to make a fuss about it.
Oh, well, I ran into Norman and Vic down at the drugstore, and they passed out 10 or 12 hints about Hazel's famous midnight poker supper, so guess where we're playing?
Well, you better let her know. She's over at the Johnsons.
Uh-oh. What big calamity is she straightening out this time?
I'll bet she's playing patty cake. Mrs. Johnson's niece and her husband and baby are over there.
Well, I didn't know they were coming to town.
Well, only the baby's staying. The parents are going on a 2-week vacation.
Oh, great. Here we go again.
Here we go again? Where?
It'll be exactly the way it was when the Blake children moved in on the other side of us. She'll be spending more time with that baby than she will be here.
Did Hazel ever neglect her duties here because of the Blake children?
Well, no, I guess not. But the point is, Hazel always gets involved. And when she gets involved, inevitably, somehow, I get involved, too.
How could she possibly get you involved with that baby, George?
That, Dorothy, is beyond my power to predict. But she will. Believe me, she will.
Hello? Hello? Speak up, please. I can't hear you. Hello? Harriet, sounds like long distance. Most likely your sister in Seattle.
Mr. Johnson, this is not long distance.
Hello, Josephine.
Mr. Johnson, this is not Josephine. This is George Baxter and...
George, what are you doing in Seattle?
I'm not in Seattle. I'm right here at home.
Oh, I am glad. And when are you coming over to see our baby?
Well, I don't know, Mrs. Johnson. I'm going over to the driving range this afternoon, and I... Well, yes, I'm sure he's very unusual, and well, maybe later. Now, will you please tell Hazel to come right home? Thank you, Mrs. Johnson. Goodbye. Oh, honestly, women and babies. Now, what's so special about a baby?
Oh, George, you've forgotten.
Did he say he wanted me to come right over?
Yes, he did, Hazel.
Oh. Well, thanks for letting me hold him. What time did you say that professional nurse was going to be here?
She just said sometime late this afternoon.
Oh, gee, I hope it's not too late. We want to get to Crystal Lake before dark.
Well, after I see what Mr. B wants, maybe I'll come back and visit with him some more, if it's all right with you.
Of course, Hazel. You're always welcome.
Please come back, Hazel. You can put him down for his nap.
To see me, Mr. B?
Yes, Hazel, I did. I'm having a poker party tonight.
Oh, and you want me to put on my usual terrific feed, huh?
That's right. There'll be five of us.
The same bunch as last time?
Yes.
Oh, your friends from Yale.
That's right.
Oh, I love putting on a spread for them.
Oh, good. Then you won't mind staying away from the Johnsons for a while to get it organized.
Oh, I'll have this done in no time. Hello, Al. This is Hazel. Mr. B's having a poker party tonight for five. Would you send over the order? Thanks, Al. Bye.
Hazel, wait a minute. You must have baby fever or something. You forgot to give him the order.
Oh, no. No, I ain't, Mr. B. You see, I have this system for special meals, like turkey dinner for Christmas, ham dinner for Easter, prime ribs roast for your birthday, and cold cuts for the poker party. And Al has marketing lists to go with each one of them. It saves me time. So now there's nothing else you want, Mr. B.
Hazel, there's one more thing. I want to warn you not to interfere with the Johnsons with that baby.
Oh, I ain't interfering. They want me. I'm welcome.
Lullaby and good night with roses bedight, creep into thy bed and pillow thy head.
Oh, it's just so sweet. I can't hardly stand it. Do you want me to run out to the car and get the rest of the baby's things? Then I could help you fix up the spare room as a nursery.
Thank you, Hazel, but we didn't have room for much in the car. Here is bottles and a few supplies. And leasehold is clothes and some diapers.
Oh. Well, if you folks will excuse me, I just remembered I gotta go clean out our attic. Yeah, Rosie, will you do that? Well, I'll leave the back door open. Oh, fine. Thanks, Rosie. Bye. Oh, hi, sport.
Hi, Hazel.
Hazel, what are all these things doing here?
Oh, the stuff I cleaned out of the attic. I've been meaning to do it for weeks.
Well, what prompted you to... Hazel, these are all baby things.
Ain't that an amazing coincidence?
What's a coincidence?
Well, I mean, me finding all Harold's old baby things going to waste and that little baby over at the Johnsons without a crib to call his own. Amazing, ain't it?
Incredible.
So what do you think we ought to do with all this stuff we were going to throw out anyway?
Well, let's see now. There's always the Goodwill.
With that little baby without a crib to call his own?
Or the Salvation Army.
With that little baby...
Hazel, since you left the decision up to me, we're going to give these things to the Goodwill.
But Mr. B...
After the Johnsons are through with them.
Oh. Harold, you got the best dad in the world.
Sure, I know it. Hazel, are you going to give my teddy bear away to the Goodwill when the Johnsons are through with him?
Oh, no, McGillicuddy. That's the one thing I wouldn't do, give away your teddy bear, not me.
That's good. I think I'm through with him, but sometimes I'm not sure.
Seems delightful. delighted with his new nursery, Hazel. As soon as he starts talking, he'll thank you for it.
Oh, I ought to thank him. I'm having a ball.
Oh, it was awfully kind of you, Hazel, offering to stay until the nurse gets here so the children could get an early start.
Between you and me and the gatepost, I hope she never gets here. I just wish we had a doll here so you could practice. I could give you some pointers on baby care.
Oh, that's a wonderful idea, Hazel. The only trouble is I gave all my dolls away a long, long time ago.
Well, I'll run over to the Blakes. Maybe the Mavis would have a doll.
Wonderful!
Eureka!
What is it, Herbert?
I've been giving considerable thought to this little plastic boat.
Boat?
My namesake is advanced for his age, Hazel, but I don't think he's quite ready yet for boating.
Oh, I think that's safe to say, Mr. Duncan.
So, not wanting a perfectly good boat to go to waste, why don't we put it on this stand, fill it with water, and use it to bathe the baby?
Oh, that's a doozy of an idea.
It means we won't have to carry him all the way to the bathroom.
Exactly, my dear. By Jove, I think I've invented something there's a crying need for.
Perhaps you should patent it, Herbert.
You could call it a bathinet.
Excellent suggestion, Hazel. Excellent.
Oh, Herbert, you're so clever at figuring things out. Without him, life would be just one long muddle.
Thank you, my dear.
I'll go get the doll.
She's been over there for almost 2 hours now. Well, finally, here she comes.
Good. Now you can stop grumbling.
I don't believe it.
You don't believe what?
She waved to me, walked right past the house, and now she's headed for the Blakes. Dorothy, you know what we're going to do?
What?
We're going to move, that's what.
Now, George.
Oh, yes, we are. We're going to move to a nice neighborhood where there aren't any neighbors. Right now, I'm going to call the Blakes and remind Hazel that we're supposed to have an early dinner tonight because of my poker party.
Excuse me, Mrs. Baxter.
Rosie, what are you doing here?
Oh, I'm fixing your dinner.
Your what?
I'm fixing your dinner. Is Mr. Baxter getting a little hard of hearing?
No, he's not. And I want to know how Hazel bamboozled you into doing her work for her.
Mr. Baxter, one sunshine girl doesn't have to bamboozle another. Our motto is, and I quote, quote, a helping hand is the only kind worth having, unquote.
And who's cooking dinner for the Craigs tonight?
The doctor's taking the missus out to dinner. He does that quite often.
Rosie, was there anything you wanted to ask me?
Oh, yes. Did you want Roquefort or Thousand Island dressing on your salad?
Roquefort, please.
I'll have it.
Oh, yes, Mr. Baxter, I know. Hazel told me. Low-cal.
Oh, Herbert, isn't this exciting? In no time at all, Hazel has taught us how to give him his bottle and bathe him and diaper him and burp him and put him to bed.
Don't forget the two lullabies and this little piggy went to market.
Why don't you practice your songs now?
All right. Twinkle, twinkle, little star.
How I wonder what you are. Up above the world so high. Like a diamond in the sky. Where you shed your little light. Twinkle, twinkle, all the night.
Oh, that's nice. That's real nice. Well, you're a lucky baby. It ain't every baby has his own personal glee club.
That must be the new nurse. Excuse me.
You know, Hazel, actually, we don't need the nurse.
What do you mean?
Well, now that you've taught us everything there is to know about taking care of little Herbert, she'll only be in the way.
Mr. Johnson, I think you need a little more experience before you take over.
Well, if you say so, Hazel, I would like to run through the burping again. That's the one thing I do feel a little shaky on.
All right. Now, you remember how to hold him?
Well.
That's right. Put him over your shoulder and pat him gently on the back. Gently until he burps. I think that was a sonic boom, Mr. Johnson. Did you think he struck gold?
Right in here, please. This is Miss Simmons. My husband, Mr. Johnson.
How do you do, Miss Simmons?
How do you do?
And Hazel Burke.
Oh, hiya, Miss Simmons. Boy, you're sure lucky to have a chance of taking care of this baby. Ain't he a doozy?
He looks healthy enough.
Oh, he's got a terrific personality.
An infant that young hasn't had time to develop personality.
Oh, yeah? Well, wait till you get a chance to know this one. How do you like the nursery?
Well, it should be satisfactory as soon as I've rearranged everything. Now, I think this crib could come down this way a bit. Oh. And that bathinet should be against the wall.
How'd she know what I was going to call my invention?
Imagine that.
Where can I dispose of this dirty thing?
Dirty thing? That's all Harold's teddy bear. And he don't like to be held by one ear.
Mrs. Johnson, there's one thing I want to make clear right from the beginning.
Of course, Miss Simmons. What is it?
I'll expect your maid to stay out of my nursery.
Your nursery?
My nursery, as I plan to stay out of her kitchen.
But, my good woman, you...
I have full responsibility of the infant, and I brook no interference. Is that clear?
Hazel's not our maid.
She's our friend.
Well, that's your privilege, of course. Now, if you would all get out of the room so that I can start my routine.
One thing that burns me is people that under my nose. And another thing, she keeps that uniform of hers so starched, she's liable to bruise the poor little baby.
Are you still grousing about that nurse?
Well, he's such a sweet little thing.
Is he as sweet as I was when I was his age?
No baby could ever be as sweet as you were, Harold.
You're darn tootin'. And another thing, babies need more than bottles and baths. They need that little thing called L-O-V-E, love.
Agreed, and that's exactly what the Johnsons are there to give him. L-O-V-E, love.
You mean we're not to be allowed in the nursery at all, Miss Simmons?
That's exactly what I mean, Mrs. Johnson.
But I won't make the same mistake again, Miss Simmons. I can assure you of that.
No, it's much better this way, and it's much easier for me to keep baby on schedule.
His name is Herbert, and he's named after me.
Mr. Johnson, I take care of more than 20 babies a year, and I cannot be expected to remember a new name every few weeks. So I call them all Baby.
Oh, I see.
Miss Simmons, when you're rocking him to sleep, would it be all right if Mr. Johnson and I stood out here and sang to him?
We've been practicing the lullabies that Hazel taught us, and we...
That is absolutely out of the question. I don't believe in lullabies. Now, I'm going to have to close the door. It's time for baby's bath, and you're creating a draft.
Oh, Herbert, it's not fair. Our own flesh and blood.
There, there, my dear.
Hazel said that next to rocking him to sleep, his bath was the most fun. Now we won't be able to even watch.
Impossible situation. And I'm not going to take it sitting down. I'm going to cope.
But what can you do, Herbert?
I'm going to dismiss the miserable creature.
But we won't get anyone else. You know she was the only nurse available at such short notice.
We'll care for my namesake ourselves.
Oh, Herbert, do you think we could?
No doubt about it. We couldn't have had a finer teacher than Hazel. And she herself said, all we need's a little more experience.
That's right. And we certainly can't get it standing outside the nursery door.
Exactly. Now, if you'll excuse me, I'm going in there.
Oh, Herbert. You're a tiger.
Well, thank you, my dear.
Three lovely ones.
Three lovely
ones. I'll take two.
Two for you.
One for me.
One. You and...
Uh-uh.
Steve, will you please mind your own business?
George, that's no way for a Yale man to talk to a lady.
All right, all right. I'll take one.
One for you and three for the dealer.
Well, I'll tell you what. I'll bet $1.
Sucker's bad. Well, I know you're bluffing, but I'm short on courage tonight.
I believe you.
Well, I'm out. Me too. Oh,
come on, coward. Straight. Ace high.
Mr. B, you want to pay me back that $250 I paid out for you yesterday?
Hazel, telephone. Mrs. Johnson.
Oh, I hope they're not in any trouble.
You know, the one thing that keeps me from giving up this miserable game?
No.
Hazel's midnight supper.
You're kidding, Mr. Johnson. Oh, please say you're kidding. Well, don't do nothing for a couple of minutes. I'll call you right back.
Anything wrong?
They fired the sergeant.
Oh, no. Why?
Because she told them they couldn't come into the nursery.
Well, that does seem a bit high-handed.
The reason she said it was because Mr. Johnson made a tiny little mistake when he was burping the baby.
What little mistake?
He was burping Mavis's doll instead. Well, the poor man, you know, it does look kind of real.
Hazel, they're not planning on taking care of that baby themselves, are they?
Oh, sure, Mrs. Johnson's getting ready to give it the 10 o'clock feeding. The only trouble is they're out of formula. So Mr. Johnson called to ask if I could recommend a chemist where they could get some more.
Well, we can help them with the formula.
I could probably talk them into getting another nurse, if you could get one at such short notice.
Which you can't.
I got an idea, but I don't think we'd get Mr. B's permission.
Hazel, why don't you tell me what it is, and maybe we'll just do it and tell him about it afterwards.
Well, fellas, it's after 2 o'clock. Want to quit?
That meal of Hazel's under our belts, we should be good for the rest of the night.
Sure. Deal him, George.
You know, you're a lucky son of a gun, George, with a woman like Hazel to take care of you and the family.
Yes, I was afraid she would be spending most of her time taking care of that baby next door, but I see I was wrong, I'm happy to say.
You know, that baby next door really has a pair of lungs.
Come on, champ, take your bottle. Come on, take your bottle. Come on.
I don't understand why he won't take it.
No, neither do I. That's a hunger cry if I ever heard one.
Oh, I hope he doesn't wake up the Johnsons.
Oh, they were so wore out when they fell into our guest room tonight, they'll never wake up. Come on, Herbie. Take your bottle.
All right, what is that baby doing here?
He's refusing to take his bottle, Mr. B.
That's not what I mean, and you know it.
The Johnson's nurse didn't work out, George, so we're taking care of the baby until we get another one.
Oh, for Pete's sake.
And the Johnsons are staying in the guest room, George, so they won't be separated from him. It was the only solution.
Dorothy, just this afternoon you said, now, George, how could Hazel get you involved with that baby?
I know why he won't take his bottle. His dad's always giving him the 2 o'clock feeding. So I guess you'll have to take over, Mr. B.
Oh, now, this is ridiculous.
He wants to come to you, darling.
Now. Kind of takes you back to when Harold was a little baby. Ain't that right, Mr. B?
Yes, Hazel, it does.
Kind of a nice feeling, ain't it?
Yes, it is.
Now, why don't you sit right down here, Mr. B, and you rock him and sing to him, and then he'll take the bottle from you.
Well, all right, we'll give it a try.
Rock-a-bye, baby, on a treetop. When the wind blows, the baker...
He's not taking it.
Well, that's because you ain't singing the right song. His dad always sings the Princeton fight song.
The Princeton fight song? Well, I'm a Yale man.
Well, it's for a good cause, George. We won't snitch.
All right. Crash through the line of blue.
Oh, come on, Mr. B. You're going swell.
Well, I'm not going to be the only one to have this on his conscience. Come on, now, we'll all sing along with George.
All right, Howard.
Crash through the line of blue and send the backs around the end. Fight, fight for every yard. Princeton's honor to defend. Rah, 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 rah. Tigers, his boombah.
Missy, look, he's taking the bottle.
The score. For we'll fight with a vim that is dead sure to win for old Nassau.
His own personal glee club. Speak to you for a minute.
What is it, Hazel?
Oh, not to you. I wanted to talk to Missy. You just go right ahead with your book. Enjoy yourself.
All right.
Don't let me disturb you. He's had a hard day at the office, you know. He deserves to have some rest. But like they say, woman's work is never done. I'm pooped.
Well, you've had a full day, Hazel. You better just rest tonight.
Well, I've been ironing for almost 2 hours. Them shirts, your shirts, Mr. B. Don't let me disturb you. Go right ahead. Enjoy your book.
All right.
I never saw a man could use up as many clean shirts in a week as he can.
Hazel, I'm sorry, but I intend to wear a clean shirt every morning and another if we entertain or go out in the evening.
Okay, Mr. B. I guess it ain't the number of shirts so much as that old iron. I've been using it for 8 years.
Well, isn't it working properly?
About as good as it ever did.
Good.
But, you know, it's an antique. They've made a lot of improvements in irons in the last 8 years, Mr. B. With a new iron, a person could probably...
Hazel, we'll buy you a new iron.
Oh, thanks, Mr. B. I didn't want to come right out blunt and ask, you know? Thanks. You know, get a new iron every week. Well, enjoy your mystery. It's got a terrific ending. You never guess it was that pretty girl, done it? Mr. B, do you look handsome? Boy, you're the best-looking man in a tuxedo I ever seen.
Well, thank you, Hazel.
Gonna be dancing and everything, huh?
Oh, sure. They've hired a small orchestra.
Oh, gee. I'd sure like to go to an affair like that. Oh, Mr. B, now don't you hang around the punch bowl. You get out there and dance.
All right, Hazel, I will. I'll be dancing a foxtrot all evening, no matter what they're playing.
Oh, I bet you're a terrific dancer. Fat men is always light on their feet.
Thanks.
Oh, Missy, do you look gorgeous.
Thank you, Hazel. Do you like the dress?
Terrific. She looks like a princess in a fairy tale, don't she, Mr. B?
She looks lovely.
Oh, and you're wearing your mother's diamond earrings.
Mm-hmm. I had George get them out of the safe deposit box. Aren't they beautiful?
Oh, yeah. But it's a shame to hide them on your ears. If it was me, I'd want to wear them on my fingers so I could look at them. Now, you two stay here. I want to get my camera.
Hazel, we have to leave. We haven't got time for pictures.
Oh, just a couple, Mr. B.
Not even one. We'll be late.
Well, you got to say goodnight to Harold anyway. Harold! Your folks is leaving.
I wonder if the Crowders will be there.
Oh, I'm sure they will.
Brother, she always traps me in a tango, and I can't dance the tango.
Are you leaving?
That's right.
It's time for you to go to bed.
You sure look swell.
Well, thank you, sir.
Well, what about me?
You look swell, too. You look like a waiter.
Well, thank you, sir, I think.
Everybody smile.
Oh, for Pete's sake, Hazel, you blinded me.
Oh, well, it's over in a sec. This will be a terrific picture. Now, you just all get
we
over there by the
stage. We don't have time for pictures.
Give me a kiss goodnight, Harold.
Smile.
Hazel.
Oh, that didn't hold you up long. Now, I want to get one more
there
right over here.
There will not be any more pictures.
You be a good boy, Harold, and go to bed.
I will.
Night, Harold.
Good night.
Night, Hazel.
Good night, Missy. Good night, Mr. B. Oh, boy, I'd sure like to go to an affair like that.
Why don't we watch some television?
Oh, no, you gotta get to bed.
You wanna take some more pictures?
No, you gotta hit the hay sport.
Oh, won't you just let me stay up for a little while?
Now, come on, you don't wanna keep your dreams waiting, do you?
My dreams?
Oh, sure, you got a lot of dreams. They can't start till you get there. I'll bet that horse of yours is waiting.
You mean Star?
Sure, the fastest horse in the West. Boy, can't you just see yourself riding him in that cowboy suit?
Yeah, shooting the bad guys with my 6 guns.
Oh, sure. You got some swell dreams coming up.
Good night, Hazel.
Good night, sport. Boy, a dance like that must be something. Announcing the arrival of Lady Hazel Burke. How'd you do? How'd you do? Oh, your lordship, leave off kissing my hand. Them cameramen is taking our pictures. Oh, my diamonds, they was mama's. Sure, they've been in the family so long they're practically wore out. What's that, your dukeship? Oh, my dress. Oh, yeah, gorgeous. I got it in Paris, France. It wasn't even on sale. It sets off my figure something terrific. Shall we dance? Oh, for Pete's sake.
Thank you. Move? Well, how can I? You're practically paralyzed.
That was only a bunt. You start acting funny, I'll make it a home run.
Oh, this is the perfect ending of a perfect day. Well, let's call the police. Let's get it over with.
I'm going to call them. Don't you worry.
Where's the phone?
It's right in here.
Well, then do it.
You sit down there and don't start acting funny.
Well, just hurry up and call the police. After this town, jail will be a relief.
There ain't nothing wrong with this town. They're putting a few of you burglars in jail won't kill her.
I'm not a burglar.
You broke into the house.
I'm hungry. I was going to take some food, sure, but that doesn't make me a burglar. Well, you're holding a ball bat. That doesn't make you Mickey Mantle.
Funny kind of fella.
Oh, just call the police. At least I'll get something to eat in jail.
You mean you ain't had no dinner?
I haven't had a bite to eat since yesterday.
Well, for Pete's sake.
Hazel, that's the best meal I ever had.
Oh, I don't know. I didn't think my biscuits was up to usual. You want another piece of pie?
No, thanks. I couldn't.
Oh, we'll have some more coffee anyway. So you was a mechanic over in Centerville, huh?
Darn good one, too. Saved up $1,200 because I opened a shop of my own. Figured this would be the town for it. What a laugh.
What do you mean?
Yesterday, I drew all my money out of the bank, said goodbye to my friends, piled the stuff in the car, and started out for here. Biggest mistake I ever made.
Well, for Pete's sake, what happened?
Well, I had to drive all night. I was happy as a bird. Got here at 7 o'clock this morning. Just when I came into town, I picked up a hitchhiker. He held me up and stole my $1,200.
No, the whole $1,200?
Didn't even leave me the wallet. Knocked me cold and left me with 40 cents to my name.
Boy, by now your poor head must be getting pretty lumpy.
Oh, it'll be all right. When I came to, I started to drive to police headquarters. And guess what? I ran out of gas.
Oh, no.
So I had to walk a mile to a gas station. I got 40 cents worth of gas in a can and walked back to the car. Hazel, the car was gone.
Gone?
Stolen. Everything. Clothes, tools, equipment, everything gone.
Oh, I could bawl.
Well, I did. Well, almost. I threw the can of gas in a ditch and started to walk to a house to ask to use the phone. I still wanted to call the police. By then, I was kind of grimy looking, and when I stepped in this man's yard, he sicked the dog on me.
Oh, no.
Look at my pants leg. Hazel, that was the last straw. This town was just too much for me. All I could think of was I wanted to get back to Centerville.
Well, then, did you call the police?
Oh, I tried once more. I flagged down a police car.
Oh, good, because them boys in blue will always help.
Not these boys in blue. They took one look at me and asked for identification, which I didn't have. Said to get out of town or they'd arrest me for vagrancy.
Well, I'm going to write a letter to the editor.
Spent the rest of the afternoon trying to earn bus fare home. I offered to carry trash, cut lawns, wash windows, anything. I couldn't even get a job as a dishwasher. Hazel, I've been pushed and shoved until, well, I broke in here.
Well, I gotta call the police, Peter.
I know you do.
Well, you know, I gotta. The folks is away and I'm responsible.
I understand.
I don't wanna. Just gotta.
So I said to her,
It's 2 a.m.
So I said, let's have another glass of punch. What I really should have said was, let's sit this one out. Your feet are killing me.
But if you think she was bad, you should have danced with him. He whispers in your ear all the time. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. It's like dancing with a metronome.
Hey, what's this? Oh, it's a note from Hazel. You better wake me before you go upstairs. I got some news for you. And Mr. B, keep away from the pie. She watches me like a hawk.
Shall we wake her?
Oh, no, I don't think so. It's too late. Besides, any news she has can keep.
I agree. Let's go to bed. Remind me to put these earrings in the safety deposit box in the morning.
All right, but I'm sure they'd be safe here.
No, maybe so, but I don't want to take any chances.
Well, they're insured, you know.
I know. They have a sentimental value of insurance.
Shh.
What?
I hear somebody snoring. It's coming from the guest room.
That must be why Hazel left that note. I wonder who it is.
I haven't the faintest idea. Some relative, I suppose. Let's take a peek.
Oh, George, you can't just barge into somebody's bedroom.
This is our bedroom in our house, and I want to know who's sleeping in there. We won't wake him up. Turn the light on. Well?
I can't find the switch. Do you know him?
No. Do you?
No.
He's wearing my pajamas.
They are, George. I gave them to you for your birthday.
Oh, I'll bet I know who it is. That cousin of mine from California, the one I've never seen. You remember his letter? He said he was coming east, and I wrote to him to be sure and stay with us. Arnold. Arnold. Are you Uncle Frank's boy, Arnold?
No, go away. It's the middle of the night.
Sorry.
Excuse us.
Come on.
I knew we shouldn't have gone in there.
Who is he?
I don't know, but Hazel wouldn't take in some stranger off the street.
I'm not so sure about that. I'm going downstairs and ask her.
You wake up, Harold. What's he doing?
Is he sick?
No, he's not sick. I got him down here on account of that fella in the guest room.
Who is that man?
Well, if you just wait outside until I slip into my wrapper, I can explain everything. It's kind of complicated.
Hazel, I just want to know who he is.
Well, he's a burglar.
Burglar?
Shh, you wake Harold.
You mean to tell me that's a burglar sleeping in the guest room?
Well, actually, he's a mechanic. This is his first burgle. Shh, you wake him.
Hazel, you come on out in the kitchen.
Well, if you just wait until I slip into my wrapper, Mr. B, I can explain everything. There's nothing to worry about, Missy. I got all your valuables right here in bed with me. Harold and your good silver. And I got the family album. And, oh, Mr. B, I got your golf trophy that you won for third place. But believe me, that golf trophy ain't no cushion. You know how the little fella has his hands up like this?
Yes.
Well, I rolled over on it, and boy, I almost hit the ceiling. While he was eating, we got to chatting, and he turned out to be one of the nicest fellas you'd want to meet. He was even on the track team when he was a boy.
Hazel, that doesn't have anything to do with it.
The man's a burglar.
Oh, no, Mr. B. He's more what you call a victim of circumstances.
He broke into a house. He's a burglar.
But he won't do it again. I made him promise.
You mean you take him at his word?
Oh, sure. If you knew what that poor man's been through today in the first place...
Hazel, you've told us.
Well, there, you see... I only hope that when he gets back to Centerville, he don't give this town a bad name. In a way, I was only helping out the Chamber of Commerce.
How do you talk to a woman like that? And what's more, what do you mean by letting him sleep in my pajamas?
Well, being as how he was a guest, I didn't think you'd want him sleeping in his underwear.
I give up. I'm calling the police and turning that man in.
Oh, no, Mr. B, you wouldn't do a thing like that. Just because he made one little mistake?
Hazel, breaking into a house is not a little mistake. Operator. Now, give me the police.
Mr. B, didn't you ever make a mistake?
Yes, but I've never broken into a house. Now, will you get your hand off the phone?
Didn't you ever do anything you was ashamed of?
Yes, but...
Yes, you're Don Tootin. Everybody has. If we was all caught, we'd have to line up to be arrested. But most people is decent, Mr. B. And if they do something they're ashamed of, they don't do it again. Now, that man upstairs is ashamed. Don't you want to give him another chance?
A chance to what? To burglarize again?
Oh, he won't do it again, Mr. B. Don't you think I'm a good judge of people?
Well, yes, but...
Sure, you want to turn in a man you never even talked to. Why, he's down and out. If you was to arrest him, it'd be kind of like kicking him.
Dorothy, what do you think?
I don't know, George. I'd hate to ruin a man's life just because of one mistake.
All right, Hazel, but I want him out of here tomorrow, and I never want to see him around here again. Is that clear?
Mr. B, you're the nicest man I ever met. You got a good heart and a generous nature.
All right, that's enough, Hazel.
I can't imagine you doing nothing you'd ever be ashamed of. What did you do?
None of your business.
I know you never stole nothing.
Thanks.
You wasn't flirting with one of them secretaries,
oh,
honey.
Oh, of course not. Come on, Dorothy, let's go to bed.
Night, Hazel.
Night.
George. George?
What's it? Oh, everything all right?
Well, everything's fine. I just wanted to ask you something.
What?
What did you do that you're ashamed of?
Oh, for Pete's sake, it's the middle of the night.
Well, I can't sleep. And you can tell me I'm your wife.
Dorothy, after all these years, it doesn't matter.
You'll sleep better if you tell me.
I was asleep, sound asleep.
We've all done things we're ashamed of. I have too. So why don't you just tell me?
All right, I'll tell you. It happened in college and...
A girl.
No. It was during a chemistry test. The professor trusted me. I broke that trust. I cheated. I got the answers from the fellow next to me.
You mean that's all there is to it?
Yes. Now, will you please go to sleep?
All right. Good night, George.
Night. Dorothy.
Mm-hmm.
What did you do you're ashamed of?
Is there anything I can do, Hazel?
Oh, sure. You can squeeze these oranges while I start the coffee.
When'll that man be down?
Well, he ought to be down any minute now. His name is Peter Warren. Now, you be nice to him.
Holy smoke, diamonds.
Dorothy, you know something? I must have been soft-headed last night.
You mean soft-hearted.
Soft-headed. I should have called the police immediately. Do you realize that he could have cleaned us out during the night?
George, my earrings.
You what?
My diamond earrings. Where are they?
Oh, that crook. Where did you put them last night?
I don't remember.
Well, think.
I took them off just before we came up the stairs.
Yes, yes.
And then we heard the snoring. I had them in my hand, and then we went into the guest room.
Oh, well, he couldn't have taken them because he was sound asleep.
Oh, wait a minute. You told me to turn on the lamp, and I couldn't find the switch. And I put my earrings on the dresser.
I'm going to take a look.
George, they're gone!
What?
And there they were on the dresser.
Oh, they was Missy's mother. She sure treasures them. Oh, the Baxters will never be able to thank you enough.
What a fool I was. He's probably headed for the nearest pawn shop.
Oh, I hope we get them back.
Operator, give me the police. This never would have happened if Hazel hadn't... I would like to report a burglary. Thank you. And I'm going to hold her strictly responsible because... Yes, Sergeant. This is Mr. George Baxter speaking. My house has been burglarized by a man named Peter Warren. Hazel, now you've done it. You've really done it this time. Your friend has disappeared and...
He ain't disappeared.
Disappeared, and he's taken Dorothy's diamond earrings with him.
He ain't disappeared. He's out in the garden working for his breakfast. And here's Missy's diamond earrings right there. Peter found them on the bureau. Missy shouldn't leave her earrings around like that. Suppose he was a crook. Missy, you shouldn't leave your mama's earrings around like that.
You found them!
He turned them into Hazel. He's out in the yard. Well, I guess I owe him an apology.
Well, as long as he don't know you suspected him, I guess it's all right. What's the siren?
Well, I call the police.
Oh, Mr. B, you're going to give our town an awful reputation in Centerville. Well, can't you just take off the handcuffs? It'll give people the wrong idea.
I can't help it, Hazel. The cuffs stay on.
I'm sorry, Peter.
Well, like I told you, Hazel, this just isn't my lucky town. But thanks for the night's rest and the food.
Do you have to take him in? He didn't steal anything.
Breaking and entering with the intent to commit burglary is a felony. He came in to steal food. He's admitted it.
What if we refuse to sign the complaint?
Well, I refuse. I ain't gonna sign nothing. And what's more, I ain't never gone bowling with you two ever again.
Hazel, we're just doing our duty.
Now, Mr. Baxter, if you don't sign the complaint, the district attorney doesn't have a case. He just wouldn't prosecute.
All right, we're not signing the complaint, so you can just let him go.
Sorry, Mr. Baxter, we'll have to take him in. If he's tried burglary, we have to check him out.
Probably got a record a mile long. Come on, you, let's go.
Well, Mr. B, I hope you're happy.
No, Hazel, I'm not. I'm very sorry this thing happened.
You just sent an innocent man to the gallows.
Hazel, he's not going to the gallows. They're just taking him down to jail so they can check on him.
Well, I hate to think of the kind of people he's going to have to associate with down there. You know what they got in that jail? Just a bunch of crooks.
Well, if he hasn't a record, they'll let him go.
When?
Well, when they check on him.
George, isn't there something we can do?
Well, Missy, maybe a lawyer could speed things up. But where's a poor man who ain't got a cent to his name going to get one? You being a lawyer, Mr. B, do you know where I could get one?
All right, Hazel. All right. I'll see what I can do.
Oh, ain't he a doozy? Oh, and Mr. B, after you get him out, be sure and tell him that he can use our guest room until he finds a place of his own.
Oh, for Pete's... All right.
And Mr. B, tell him I'm letting out a pair of your old slacks so he'll have something decent to wear.
So it proves that first impressions can be wrong, because I thought this was the unfriendliest town in the whole world. Then I met Hazel, and you folks you've been just wonderful to me.
Oh, that's all right, Peter.
We're glad to do it.
Everybody have enough to eat?
Oh, I can hardly move.
Oh, I was going to ask you to take out the trash for me.
Oh, sure I would.
No, sit down, Peter. You can do that later. I was just figuring how you could pay back the Baxters what you owe them.
What's that?
Well, Mr. B, you don't want her to be a freeloader.
Well, certainly not.
And if he ain't the one to pay for the broken window, I don't know who is.
I want to pay for it.
Ain't he nice? Now, let's see. Room and board will cost you $2 a day. That okay?
Well, that's more than fair.
Now, then, them pants of Mr. B's.
Wait a minute, Hazel. I don't want anything for those pants.
Just what I was going to say, Mr. B. They ain't worth nothing. I let them out oftener than I do the dog. You see, he has this terrific weight problem.
Hazel?
Well, if he's going to be around for a few days, he's sure to find out. I notice you ain't much on vegetables either.
Well, no,
you never touched your beans, and you just pecked at the salad. Salad and beans is full of vitamins. You know, they give you strong bones and teeth. When was you at your dentist last?
For a year or so, I guess.
Oh, for Pete's sake, I gotta put that down on my list. You need a checkup.
Peter, welcome to the Baxters. When you broke in here, you didn't know what you were letting yourself in for.
Hazel.
Turned out to be a nice day after all, huh?
Yeah, but it's awful hot to be packing a load like this.
How does this sound to you? I got a whole pitcherful inside sour the way you like it, and ginger cookies to go with it.
Oh, well, thanks, Hazel, but Rosie filled me all up with iced tea and cake.
Oh.
Sure was a relief to sit down over there and cool off. They've had the house air-conditioned, you know.
No, I didn't. She didn't say a word to me about it.
Well, I just put it in. I gotta mosey along. I gotta make up the time that I lost at Rosie's. Keep cool.
How do you like that, Rosie? Getting herself air-conditioned without telling me. Well, two can play that game.
To air-condition a house this size would cost $2,000 or $3,000.
Oh, sure would, Mr. B, if you was to pay cash. But I know you don't want to set out a lump sum like that.
Well, Hazel, I'm glad you realize that.
If you was to stagger it over 3 years, that would bring it to something like $73.83 a month.
Hazel.
Now, George.
Why now, George? Did I raise my voice? Do I look angry?
Well.
What could be more comfortable than an air-conditioned house? Now, if we can figure out some way to pay for it, I think we should go ahead and do it.
Now, that's using the old bean, Mr. B. How much do you pay for your lunches? Not less than a dollar and a half, I bet. Now, if I was to pack you a nice, nourishing sandwich and a thermos...
Hazel, George can't take his lunch to the office in a paper bag.
Why not? If there's something we really want, we should be willing to sacrifice to get it. Right, Hazel?
Right.
However, Hazel, you must realize that the $73.83 monthly payment does not represent the entire expense. You see, there'll be the cost of electricity to run it, depreciation, interest we could earn on the money, etc.
What etc.? You named everything in the book.
All I'm getting at is, would you be willing to assume some of the financial burden by taking a slight cut in salary?
Well, how much?
$73.83 per month.
Boy, sure feels like it's going to turn out to be a scorcher, huh?
Weatherman predicts a very pleasant 76 degrees.
Oh, yeah? You know where they take those official temperature readings? Down the basement of City Hall, which is probably air-conditioned.
City Hall doesn't have a basement.
They do have air conditioning, though. I know because when I went to get our dog licenses...
Dorothy, that has nothing to do with the case. They do not take temperature readings in an air-conditioned room.
Well, they certainly don't take them in my kitchen.
Harold, don't shovel in your food.
I want to go out and play before it gets too hot.
All right, you may be excused.
Thanks, Dad. Hey, Mother, can I wear my trunks over to Jimmy's?
No, dear, it isn't warm enough yet to go without your shirt.
No, your mother's right. If you take off your shirt this early in the summer, what will you do when it's really hot?
Oh, Hazel.
Boy, it's sure going to be hot here this August. That's what I was telling Rosie.
Oh, how is Rosie?
Oh, she's fine. Well, she gives me a pain, though. Always bragging about her job and the folks she's working for. Well,
the Craigs are nice.
Oh, sure. But they're not the only ones that have got air conditioning.
Oh, I didn't know they were putting it in.
Oh, well, I didn't either. Oh, that Rosie's a sly one. I never would have known it if Bonnie hadn't told me.
Hazel, I'll have some hot coffee.
Oh, sure.
And I'm not interested in Rosie or the Craigs or their air conditioning.
Okay, but don't blame me if the mail is late.
If the mail is late? What's the connection between the mail and the Craigs' air conditioning?
I don't know. It must have something to do with Barney.
Have you ever thought of getting a portable air conditioner?
No.
Well, I could use it in my kitchen in the daytime, and you could use it in your bedroom at night.
Hazel, once and for all, finally and unequivocally, no matter what happens to the mail, I cannot afford to air condition this house. I may not even have a job in a couple of months.
George, what do you mean?
I'm sorry. I didn't mean to pop off. It's not that serious.
Not serious? George, darling, if there's something wrong, why haven't you told me?
There's nothing wrong. All I meant was that I've been with Butterworth, Hatch, and Noel for 5 years now. And if they don't make me a full partner soon, I'm going to resign.
Is that all? Boy, for a minute there, you had me worried.
Is that all?
I hadn't intended telling you yet, but you both might as well be prepared.
George, they should have made you a partner a long time ago.
Sure, you're the best lawyer in the whole city.
And if Mr. Butterworth doesn't realize that, there are plenty of other places that will.
I was thinking we might have the Butterworths over for dinner some night soon.
Good idea.
And I could have it out with him in a nice, friendly way.
Sure, if one of my dinners don't give you a full partnership, nothing will.
Hazel, I'm counting on that.
I'll call Mrs. Butterworth right now.
Good.
Yeah, I better start planning my menu. Mr. Butterworth's crazy about seafood. Maybe I'll have curry crab. And then first, a little cold vichyssoise. No, maybe I better have broiled lobster. Curried food don't set so good on some people. You know, we don't want to give them heartburn. That's the one thing we don't want to give them.
Hey, so we're going to leave the menu entirely up to you.
Mr. B, I wouldn't have nagged you if I'd known you had something important on your mind.
I know, Hazel.
So help me, from now on, you ain't going to hear one more word about air conditioning. No matter what happens to my social life. Now, let's see. I think I'll have cracked crab instead of the broiled lobster. It's so hot. And grapefruit and avocado cocktail.
Ever gonna raise $249.95?
And it just might be that I've got a nice piece of apple pie.
Oh, no, Rosie, Rosie, please. I couldn't do it. I've had enough. As soon as I finish my tea, I've got to be on my way.
Okay.
Oh, Hazel! Come on in and cool off.
Oh, I'm sorry. I didn't know you was entertaining.
Oh, take my chair, Hazel. I've got to be going.
Oh, no, you don't have to run on my account. I just dropped in for a minute to ask if I could borrow something.
Oh, I was just going. Not that I want to. Now, I could stay around here all day if I didn't have my job to do. Rosie, thanks a lot for the delicious refreshments. I'll see you tomorrow.
Bye, Barney.
You too, Hazel. See you around.
I hope you're not mad at me, Hazel.
Mad? No. Why? What for?
Finding Barney here.
Oh, I got no strings on Barney. Don't matter to me where he spends his time. I got more important things to think about.
Oh, like what?
Like planning the dinner for Mr. B's boss. It's so hot today, I'm going to have cracked crab. I wanted to borrow the ice crusher. That's why I come over.
Oh, sure. Hi, Hazel.
Oh, hi, Charlie.
What a pleasant surprise for my eyes.
How's the antique business?
Oh, splendid, splendid. Sorry I can't stay and chat, but I can't wait to hook up this air conditioner. I sure need it.
Air conditioner? You sold him the air conditioner?
Well, I didn't, Hazel. I only work here. Well, it was in the master bedroom. Naturally, they don't need it now they got the whole house done.
How much did he pay them for it?
$40.
$40? Do you know what them things cost? You might have given me a chance at it. I'd have done as much for you.
Well, I had no idea you'd be interested.
Oh, like heck you didn't. Charlie! Oh, he's gone. A fine friend you turned out to be, Rosie Hammaker.
I knew you were mad. I knew the minute you walked through that door and saw Bonnie visiting here with me that you were mad. I could tell by the expression on your face. I said to myself, Rosie, Hazel's going to be mad. She's going to try to pick a fight with you about something, just as sure as your name's Rosie Hammaker.
Oh, go turn down your thermostat. $42.50, cash on the barrelhead.
If I were a rich man, Hazel, I'd give you the air conditioner.
$45.
I would have it wrapped in a box and tied up with a silk ribbon 3 inches wide.
$50.
I would have it delivered to your doorstep in a shiny new truck with gold lettering on the side, Charlie's Antique Shop, with 2 P's and an E. But
you ain't a rich man, Charlie, and you ain't never gonna be, unless you make up your mind to take a fast 25% profit on your merchandise.
But, my dear lady, that air conditioner is not merchandise. It's a capital investment.
You mean it ain't for sale at any price?
When I had a junk shop, it didn't matter how hot it got in here. People don't expect modern conveniences in a junk shop.
Okay, Charlie.
But now that I am the proprietor of a fancy antique business, Hazel, I've got to compete with Meriwether down the street. She has air conditioning, and I have to have air conditioning.
And I gotta have air conditioning. But I see your point. I don't blame you, Charlie.
Wait a minute. I have here the solution to your whole problem. Look. A genuine antique Spanish fan. Handmade lace and mother of pearl on the end. For one person, how much air conditioning do you need?
Oh, no thanks, Charlie.
At Meriwether, they would charge you $15 or $16 for this. But to you, $1.25.
I'll give you $1 if you'll throw in this cup and saucer.
Hazel, that's Haviland. $3.25 would be my rock bottom price.
Oh, this is nice. $22.50. Oh, these are pretty plates.
What an eye you have. I should make you a partner.
Do you only have 5 of them?
Do you know how long it took me to collect those 5 plates? Longer than I have been in business. Dresden. See in the back here, see this mark? It means they were made in 1725.
Oh, they're pretty.
Sometime I get discouraged, Hazel. I look around me and say, Charlie the junk man, Who are you trying to impress, calling yourself an antique dealer? And then I dust off my Dresden fruit plates, and all my dreams are possible again.
You're really crazy about them, ain't you, Charlie?
I give anything for more of these plates. Someday I will complete my set. And who is going to call me a junk man then?
Well, nobody calls you one now, not when I'm around.
To you, Hazel, my very good friend, I will sell this Evian cup and saucer for $1.25. Oh. And this fan is a present from me.
Oh, thanks, Charlie. There you are.
You know, gift wrapping I don't have.
Oh, that's all right. I got the car parked just down the block.
Anytime you're in the neighborhood, drop in and cool off.
Thanks. May I help you?
Oh, yes. Do you have any cups and saucers in Haviland in this pattern?
Well, let's see, shall we? You're a collector of Haviland.
Well, in a small way.
No, I'm afraid I don't have this particular pattern. But I do have something you like, and it's very chic to mismatch.
Well, I ain't the chic type.
How about some dinner plates?
Mm-hmm. That's a nice cut glass bowl you have in the window. How much is that?
Oh, it's the star pattern. Isn't it lovely? I can see you have excellent taste. It's $75.
Oh.
But I've had it in stock for quite a while, so I'll let you have it for $60.
Well, I'd have to think about it. What's that old dish?
You do have good taste, but it's a fruit bowl. Oh, isn't it lovely? Old Dresden, very rare.
Yes, it's very pretty, but I don't have any use for it.
Oh, well, it's really a museum piece.
I could use a couple of plates, fruit plates. You don't happen to have any in that design?
Well, it just so happens that I do. Four. One has an age crack, but the other three are in excellent condition.
Just for kicks, what are you asking for them?
Well, in order to make a new customer. And if you take all five pieces, that would be $30 for the bowl, and 24.50 times four, let's say $125.
Well, I'd have to think about it. How much is this?
$6, and you couldn't touch it for a penny under 12 in New York. Oh, I really shouldn't, but I'll let you have it for $4.50.
Well, it's very pretty, and the price is right at $4.50.
Yes, I couldn't let it go for a penny under that.
But I spent so much for the cup and saucer. Well, I'm really getting kind of tired of Haviland. What about a trade?
Well,
this cup and saucer's worth at least 3 1/4, and I'll give you this and 50 cents cash on the barrel head.
$1. 75?
How much is this star pattern compo dish?
$12 you pay for this at Meriwether. But I'll give it to you for what it cost me, $8.50.
Well, this is worth $6, but I'll give it to you for $5. I'll give you $7 for the compote. That's $2 cash money.
All right.
Here we are. Two.
Hello? Hi, darling.
Hi. I was wondering if you wanted me to bring anything home.
No, not a thing.
Want to ask Hazel? I'll hang on.
She isn't home.
She isn't home? Doesn't she realize we've got company coming tonight?
Now, George, don't get excited. Dinner's all prepared. I looked. She must have gotten up at the crack of dawn.
Well, where is she? When's she coming back? Dorothy, If anything goes wrong tonight with the Butterworths there...
Stop worrying. Hazel wouldn't let us down.
She better not. Well, okay. Call me if you need anything. Bye, honey.
Bye-bye. And don't worry.
And that's worth $12, and it'll go with a punch bowl in the window. And besides, this chair needs a lot of work done on it, you know.
Miss Burke, I enjoy doing business with a woman who appreciates fine things.
To do is tighten the legs and just sand it down a little, and you could get at least $25 for that.
I'm out of my mind, but all right.
That's $7 you owe me.
Yeah. And 5 to 7.
Oh, well, thanks.
A customer who'll give her eye teeth for it.
I'm asking $125 for it.
I'll take it on consignment. I'll split the profit with you.
No, them Dresden fruit plates ain't doing you no good. It's gonna be years before you complete a whole set. Give me $10 cash and it's a deal.
My fruit plate? Hazel! You found my fruit plate. Hazel, my friend, how did you ever get a hold of them?
Oh, it wasn't easy.
You can have anything you want. My old shop, my life.
Just your air conditioner.
Oh, gladly. Gladly.
And this is a little present I'm throwing in extra.
Oh, no.
Look out for my air conditioner. That should be delivered in good condition or the whole deal is off.
I'll guard it with my life. I shall install it with my own two hands. I shall never forget your kindness. I shall take you to the movies tonight if you'll do me the honor.
Oh, thanks, Charlie. Not tonight. We're having company for dinner some other time. Oh, Mr. B, where you been?
Holy cow, it's hot in here.
The Butterworths is here already. Missy's giving them a cool drink inside.
I got held up in traffic. Is everything all right?
Oh, sure. Here, freshen yourself up with this cool towel. If you're going to be a full partner, you got to look like one.
A night like this, I'll be lucky if he doesn't fire me. Ooh, that feels good.
Yeah. I saw that trick in a Japanese movie on the Late Show. Ain't it a doozy?
Oh, it's terrific.
You all right?
Yeah, here.
There we go.
Okay, thank you, Hazel.
Oh, wait a minute, Pete. Would you take these in for me?
Hot hors d'oeuvres on a night like this?
Anytime anything I serve ain't satisfactory, I can always get a job as a geisha girl.
Thank you, Mr. Butterworth.
Well, after a day like this, it's a real pleasure to be in this lovely, cool home.
George, is that you?
George is here.
Yes, darling.
Sorry to be late. Good evening, Mrs. Butterworth.
Hello.
Mr. Butterworth, so glad we could come.
You must be very glad to get home and cool off, George.
Yes, yes, I am.
Walter, just look at this beautiful flower arrangement. Your touch is exquisite.
It's George's taste that I admire. And after all, he picked Dorothy.
Oh, well, thank you both.
Dorothy, where'd that come from?
Hazel.
Well, it's a lifesaver, but where did Hazel find money to buy?
Well, according to her, she got it for nothing and made a $10 profit on it.
You're a lucky young man, George. Nice home, beautiful wife. Cook like Hazel. Hope you appreciate your good fortune.
Oh, I do. Believe me, I do.
Good night.
Good night.
Oh, wasn't that marvelous? I'm so proud of you.
Me too. The old boy was sure in a good humor, wasn't he?
Hazel, guess what? George has been made a full partner. Butterworth, Hatch, Knoll, and Baxter. Oh, doesn't that sound wonderful?
I didn't even have to ask him. He asked me.
They should have put your name first. You're the best darn lawyer in the whole city, and they know it.
Oh, come on, Hazel.
Well, I guess my dinner didn't hurt either.
Oh, it was delicious, Hazel.
You know, my hollandaise sauce with cracked crab is one of my specialties. I hope you don't mind. I invited Bonnie over for a snack tonight. He's almost as crazy about cracked crab as Mr. Butterworth.
Of course we don't mind. Hazel, I just don't know how to thank you.
Oh, no thanks is necessary. Just help me get my air conditioner out to my kitchen where it belongs before Bonnie gets here.
Oh, sure, Hazel. And thanks very much for letting us use it.
Oh, I'm glad to give you the loan of it.
Oh, it was awfully nice of you, Hazel.
Well, now that Mr. B's a full partner, maybe you can afford to get one of your own. There we are. You know, Missy, you couldn't ask for a more lovable, kinder, smarter man. If only he didn't have that little stubborn streak.
Hazel! Dorothy!
George, darling, I know you're tired and irritable, but please don't shout like that.
I'm sorry, dear. You're right. I am tired and I am irritable. But I've worked day and night on those contracts with very little sleep, and now Griffin is in there tearing them apart. Where's Hazel?
Well, she isn't here this morning.
What do you mean she isn't here? She works here. We pay her to be here. Why isn't she here?
Well, she's gone to the graduation exercises.
The what?
Well, Mr. and Mrs. Merrick, he owns the bowling alley where Hazel bowls. Well, their son graduates from law school today, and they invited Hazel to go along.
Oh. Well, could Griff and I have some coffee in the den? Black. Real black.
Yes, darling, I'll get it for you right away. And George, I know Hazel's having a good time. You know how overwhelmed she is with education.
Congratulations. I wish you all the luck in the world. Congratulations. Everybody's very proud of you today. Congratulations. I wish you all the luck in the world.
Thank you.
How many more students in the class?
About 287.
Oh, I don't want to miss none of them. Congratulations. Oh, you ain't a student.
I should say not. I had to teach these numbskulls.
Hazel, we brought you here to see Alan graduate. You didn't have to congratulate everybody.
Oh, well, you know, some of these kids ain't got any parents here to be proud of them. So I'm just trying to fill in, give them something they deserve. Oh, by the way, I didn't congratulate you yet, Alan.
Well, thank you, Hazel. I'd like you to meet one of my best friends, Jack Chambers.
Oh, yes, I met you about 175 handshakes back.
Hazel's our all-time women's champion on my dad's bowling alley. Oh, there's Professor Maltz. Mom, Dad, I'd like you to meet him. Will you excuse us, Hazel?
Oh, sure. Go right ahead. So, you and Alan is opening a law office together. Is that right?
Oh, no, I'm going in with my father. I don't know just what Alan will do. It seems all his plans have gone haywire.
Oh, what do you mean?
Well, he planned to open an office over in Susanville. They've got a lot of new defense industries over there. But a couple of weeks ago, he just gave the whole thing up.
Why?
I don't know. He won't talk about it. He just shuts up like a clam the minute you mention it. So I don't know what he'll do.
He ought to get a job with Butterworth, Hatch, Knoll, and Baxter.
They're one of the top firms in town. Do you know somebody there?
Well, I just happen to work for Mr. George Baxter, personally.
Boy, if he could get in there.
And I happen to know that Mr. B's been working very hard lately, and he needs an assistant. You know, to get Mr. Griffin off his neck.
Griffin, the head of Griffin Industries, that firm that's growing like wildfire?
Oh, Mr. Griffin's industries ain't growing half as fast as Mr. Baxter's nervous breakdown. That poor man's been working 25 hours a day.
Hey, Jack, can you come over here a second? My sister wants to take a picture of us.
You don't mind, do you?
No, not if I get a copy.
It's a deal.
Hazel? You'll join us for lunch, won't you?
Oh, no, thanks.
Oh, please, Hazel.
No, I gotta get home and fix lunch for Mr. Griffin and Mr. B.
And I gotta take the cap and gown back to the costume store. I only rented it for one day.
I'll drop it off for you. You gotta have lunch with your mom and dad. This is a special day. You gotta celebrate.
Hey, Alan, congratulations. I just heard the good news.
Well, what news?
Well, you're joining the firm of Butterworth, Hatch, Knoll, and Baxter. It's now Butterworth, Hatch, Knoll, Baxter, and Merrick.
Where did you hear that?
Well, it's all over the campus. Jack just told me. You're taking over the Griffin Industries account from Mr. Baxter.
Well, it's not that I wouldn't like to get in with that firm, but I wonder who started a rumor like that.
Some little bird must have done it. Some little bird didn't know enough to keep her big mouth shut.
Enjoy yourself, Hazel.
Oh, it was beautiful. I never enjoyed anything so much except your wedding. I nearly busted out crying three times.
What are you wearing that funny hat for?
What do you mean, funny hat? Boy, there's nothing funny about a mortarboard. When you see somebody wearing this, you know they got something underneath it. Say, I look pretty intelligent, don't I?
All college students wear caps and gowns when they graduate, Harold.
Did Hazel graduate?
Oh, now, sport, you know better than that. The only school I ever went to was the School of Hard Knocks. Don't look like I'm ever going to graduate from that.
Then why are you wearing it if you didn't graduate?
Well, Alan Merrick rented it, and I said I'd take it back for him. I thought maybe some of these brains would rub off on me.
The coffee? George is working in the den with Mr. Griffin, and I'll bet they've drunk three pots of black coffee.
Someday you may be wearing one of these, boy.
Poor George, he's simply exhausted.
Now that Mr. B's a full partner, what he ought to have is an assistant to help him out in the office.
Oh, I know. I wish he had one. He's been given full responsibility for Mr. Griffin's contract, and when he works so hard, he gets terribly cranky. It's getting worse and worse.
Now, ain't that a coincidence? Alan Merrick had some plans of his own, but they fell through. And I know he'd love to work in Mr. B's office. And he thinks Mr. B's the best lawyer in the whole city.
Well, I don't know how George feels about an assistant, but I think it's a wonderful idea. Especially if you take over all of Mr. Griffin's business.
Here, I'll take that in for you, Missy. I'll get in a little early spade work. Oh, Mr. B, I was just bringing you some fresh java.
Oh, well, thanks, Hazel, but we don't have time for it now. We're due at a meeting. Come in, Mr. Griffin. Be right there.
Mr. B, you look kind of poorly.
Hazel, after all I've been through these past couple of days, I don't care how I look.
Oh, you gotta care, Mr. B. Like my pop always said, you gotta keep your chin up, even if your tail is dragging on the ground.
Now look, Hazel, I appreciate your sympathy, but please don't discuss my mental and physical degeneration in front of Mr. Griffin. Not while I'm handling his money.
Mr. B, you know what you need? Some young fella to help you out in the office.
Don't think the idea hasn't occurred to me. I've been thinking about it plenty these past couple of days, but I just don't know who to get.
Are you kidding? Well, I'm just a little girl that can help you out. I got another one of my bright ideas right out of my top drawer. Hi, Mr. Griffin.
Hello, Hazel.
I was just saying what Mr. B needs is a fresh new brain in the office.
You can say that again, Hazel.
Well, I mean an assistant, you know, that can help him out.
I was telling her that I'd been thinking about getting somebody, possibly a junior partner.
I think that's an excellent idea. George, I've got just the person for you.
But...
graduated with top honors, strong personality, dynamite, electrify your office. And you know, George, I wouldn't recommend anybody to you that I wouldn't trust with my own business. Hazel, I want to thank you for bringing this up. But we've got more important matters to discuss right now. Come on, George. Bye, Hazel.
Bye, Hazel.
Hazel, did you get in your early spade work?
Oh, sure. I dug a lovely hole, and then Mr. Griffin put his big fat foot in it.
Well, I must say, Mr. Griffin was very enthusiastic about my taking a legal assistant into the office. What'd you say, Hazel?
I didn't say nothing. I was just clearing my throat.
He mentioned it again when I left him. The way he talked, you'd think he was recommending somebody for the Supreme Court. He mentioned something about bringing his candidate by later this evening.
Mm.
Hazel, I wish you'd gargle with something.
That's for me. I'll get in the kitchen. Baxter Residence.
Hello, Hazel. This is Alan. I just got home and there was a message for me to call you as soon as I got in.
Well, I called you right after Mr. B left. Where was you? Oh, never mind. Hold on. I gotta serve the meat course.
You know something, Dorothy? She's taking so long, she really may be gargling.
Oh, George. By the way, did Mr. Griffin say who he was recommending?
Guess what I got for you tonight.
Dad, look, stuffed pork chops.
Your favorite, darling?
Yeah.
Well, you don't seem very enthusiastic. Have you gotten tired of them?
Well, how could I? She never serves them because she says they're too fattening. The only time she puts them on the table is when she wants to hit me for a raise or something.
Hazel isn't going to ask you for a raise, George. You gave her one last... What's the matter?
Every time she serves stuffed pork chops, it's like a sword of Damocles hanging over my head. Something's about to hit me, but I don't know just what it is.
Do you want to change places?
No, thanks, son. But I always know when Hazel's playing up to my weaknesses. Now, for example, when she serves sweet potatoes and marshmallows, it usually means she's had an accident in my car.
Sweet potatoes and marshmallows.
Don't look so tragic, George. I can tell you she hasn't had any accident in your car.
Well, whatever it is, I am facing something like the Japanese earthquake.
Say, Alan, you said this morning you'd like to get into Mr. B's law firm, didn't you?
Yes, I'm going over to his office tomorrow morning.
No, tomorrow'll be too late. You gotta get here tonight. Get over here right away. I'm getting them all ready for you with stuffed pork chops and sweet potatoes with marshmallows.
Well, I don't want to disturb him in his home. I just don't think it's right to intrude.
Intrude nothing. It's who gets here firstest with the mostest. Mr. Griffin is pushing somebody else for the job.
Well, if it's to Mr. Baxter's interest to favor a client, I'd say he's absolutely right.
Listen, if you're going to be a lawyer, you better stop holding the door open for somebody else and start walking in yourself.
Well, I hadn't thought about it like that. I guess you're right.
You're darn tootin' I am. Because Mr. B ain't no pushover, you know. If this boy ain't right, Mr. B won't take him, no matter if Mr. Griffin is a client. But if this other fella ain't too bad, Mr. B might say yes before he even knew you was interested.
All right, I'll come right over. It'll only take me a few minutes.
Oh, jeepers, that must be Mr. Griffin now. He sure ain't letting no grass grow under them size 12s. But don't you worry. I don't care who he brings. Mr. B couldn't find nobody better than you. So start running. I'll get it.
Good evening, Hazel.
I guess we're pretty early.
You sure are.
But I didn't want to waste 1 minute introducing Mr. Baxter to his new assistant, Gail Sanders. Just graduated from law school today. Top honors, highest grades in the class. Phi Beta Kappa.
Where is this Gail?
You're just putting on some lipstick. Hazel, this is Miss Gail Sanders, Hazel's housekeeper for the Baxters.
How do you do? I hope we're not interrupting your dinner.
Not at all. I probably won't eat for a week.
Come right in, my dear. Well, George, this is the young lady I was telling you about. Miss Gail Sanders, daughter of my best friend, Bill Sanders.
I'm very happy to meet you, Miss Sanders.
Mr. Baxter, I can't tell you how much I've been looking forward to meeting you.
Just graduated from law school today. Top honors, highest grades in the class. Phi Beta Kappa.
Yeah, I heard you before.
Yeah, it bears repeating.
Oh, may I present my wife? Darling, this is Miss Sanders.
How do you do? I'm so happy to meet you.
And this is our son, Harold.
How do you do, Harold?
Hello. Isn't she the prettiest girl you ever saw?
She sure is. Brutus.
Not only is she a crackerjack lawyer, she can even speak Latin.
Oh, Mr. Griffin, you have to study Latin in order to understand law. It's mostly Latin.
I thought it was Greek.
George still has a good command of Latin. He often quotes Horace and the other Roman poets.
Really? Go on, George. Say something to her in Latin and see if she can understand you.
Well, I can't think of a better time than to quote from the poet Horace. Ad eum adducta est virgo eximia forma.
What'd he say?
I'd rather not say.
Huh? Go on.
He said, pardon my blushes, to him was brought a maiden of exceptional beauty.
Hazel, I wish you'd do something about that throat. O virgo non tibi est vultus mortalis.
What'd he say?
Oh, maiden, you do not have the face of a mortal.
Isn't that something? We're listening to a language that's been dead for 1,500 years.
Ain't long enough for me.
Only real scholars can speak Latin.
Oh, I don't know. I can dash off a few sentences every now and then. Novus odo seclorum e pluribus unum.
What does that mean?
Well, I don't know. I just said I talked it. I didn't say I understood it. I run across it every now and then on my favorite reading matter. $1 bill.
George, I want to get this settled. Are you going to accept the assistant I recommended or not? And when does she start to work?
This sounds like a tactful moment for me to remark about your home. It's absolutely lovely, Mrs. Baxter. Well,
thank you. Care to see it?
Very much.
Well, this is the dining room over here. And out here we have a terrace we're rather proud of.
I'd love to see it.
Hey, Spud, where you going?
She's so pretty, I just like to look at her.
He's growing up faster than I thought.
Well, she's certainly a lot prettier than I expected.
That little lady is going to be a great asset in your office, George. All your clients will fall in love with her.
Well, maybe, Mr. Griffin. But I'm trying to run a law office, not a Lonely Hearts Club.
Lonely Hearts? Believe me, George, there won't be any Lonely Hearts with her around. As a matter of fact, you'll probably be seeing a lot more of me.
Boy, that's all we need.
Mr. Griffin.
She'll twist your men clients around her little finger.
Mm-hmm, and their wives will twist their little fingers around my neck. Mr. Griffin, I'd like...
Griffin, what Mr. B is trying to say is he don't want to do nothing that'll make Missy jealous.
That's not what I'm trying to say at all. Why should she be jealous? I have a pretty secretary, my two stenographers are very pretty, and the elevator operators in the building are downright beautiful.
Don't that make you stop and think?
Well, if my wife isn't jealous now, she never will be.
George, Miss Sanders is more than beautiful. She graduated first in her class.
Well, Mr. B admits he was 79th. What are you trying to do, give him an inferior complex?
Never mind, Hazel. The fact is, I'd rather have a young man in the office.
Well, now you're talking, Mr. B, and I got just the young man for you, Alan Merrick.
Alan Merrick?
Sure.
Name sounds familiar.
His father owns a bowling alley. I went to his graduation exercises this afternoon. He had plans of his own, but they blew up. And I know he'd love to be in your office.
Merrick. Oh, I remember now. The dean of the law school recommended him. Mr. Griffin, before I make a decision, I really think I ought to talk with him.
Do you have his phone number?
Oh, just leave everything to me. I'll tell him that you want to talk to him right away.
There he is.
Boy, it's about time you got here. I hope you can talk faster than you can run.
Well, I didn't run, Hazel. I drove.
When I called you, I didn't know Mr. Griffin had an ace in the hole. Boy, he pulled out an ace I didn't even know was in the deck. Mr. B., this is Alan Merrick.
Alan, nice to know you.
Thank you.
And that's Mr. Griffin.
Hello.
How do you do?
I think your house is so lovely. And this is Mrs. Baxter.
How do you do?
And I guess you know Miss Sanders since you two graduated together today.
Yes, we've met. Hello, Alan.
Hello, Gail.
Look, George, I want to get this settled. I want to know if you're going to take Miss Sanders as your assistant or not. And when does she start to work?
Well, I...
Mr. Griffin, Mr. B said that he wanted a young man in his office.
Oh. I didn't know you were considering Alan for the same position. In that case, Mr. Baxter, I'd like to withdraw my application.
Hazel didn't tell me you were being considered. Mr. Baxter, I appreciate your willingness to consider me, but I think it'd be wiser to take Miss Sanders here. After all, she graduated at the top of the class, and besides, I have some plans of my own.
Your plans went bust, and you know it.
George, I'd like to speak to you alone for a minute in the den.
Your house is so charming, Mrs. Baxter. Would it be asking too much of you to show me the upstairs?
Oh, no. I'd love you to see it.
You're in love with her, ain't you?
What makes you say that?
Oh, I saw the way you was looking at her. What happened?
Well, Hazel, I'd rather not talk about it.
Probably none of my business. Mr. B says that's my specialty.
All right, Hazel, it's true. I love her. And she loves me, I know she does.
Did you have a fight?
No, a difference of opinion. We were engaged to be married until a couple of weeks ago. Planned to open an office in Susanville where the new defense plants are.
I know, your friend told me this morning.
I thought if we opened in a small way with small cases, we could build up a practice and still have time for each other. Time to be in love.
And she didn't go along with that, huh?
Well, her father has a lot of big, important, influential friends here, like Mr. Griffin. She decided it would be better if we opened an office here and started at the top. But I knew that wouldn't give us any time for ourselves. So, might as well leave now, so she can be free to take the job. Evidently, that's what she wants.
Oh, wait a minute, Alan. You ain't gonna go until you have a cup of coffee with me, are you?
No, of course not.
Come on out in the kitchen.
And this is the master bedroom.
Oh, it's even lovelier than the guest room.
Well, Mr. Griffin spent a few nights in the guest room. He has a way of tying the curtains in knots, you know, to let the air in.
Oh, I got good news for you, Miss Sanders. I was listening at the den door. I think you got the job.
Oh, but I really don't want it if Alan... I mean, Mr. Merrick wants it.
Oh, well, it ain't a question of what Mr. Merrick wants. It's what Mr. Griffin wants. And it'll make life a lot easier for us, won't it, Missy?
It'll certainly be a relief for George to get some rest.
Sure, he's been working so hard, he's a human wreck.
I can't deny it. He's been so irritable and cross, he's made everybody miserable.
And it's sure tough on my coffee budget. Mr. B stays up all night, night after night, drinking pot after pot of black coffee.
But Mr. Baxter's an important attorney. I didn't think he'd have to labor like that.
Oh, he won't after he gets an assistant. And it sounded like they're turning Mr. Griffin's affairs all over to you.
Really?
Oh, well, he's not too bad to get along with. He just have to do everything his way. The trouble is finding out what his way is. Like, for instance, this morning, Mr. Bead worked 48 hours straight on them contracts, and Mr. Griffin came in and tore them all up.
Well, I knew Mr. Griffin was blunt, but I had no idea he was so irascible.
Well, all I'm interested in is George getting some rest. He's so desperately in need of sleep. I hope you can help him, Miss Sanders.
Oh, sure she can. She's younger. She don't need so much sleep. And besides, she's beautiful. Mr. Griffin won't yell at her. Although you'd be surprised at who people yell at when there's money involved.
So don't you think you're giving Miss Sanders a rather one-sided picture of Mr. Griffin?
Oh, sure. If I can't talk about a person's better side, I just keep my mouth shut. Hi, Alan. Miss Sanders says she'd like a cup of coffee, too.
Do you mind, Alan?
No, of course not. Has there been any decision yet?
No, Mr. Baxter and Mr. Griffin are still in the den. But it doesn't matter what they decide. I've already told them that I won't take the position if you want it.
Well, I'm on record myself. I won't take it if you want it.
Kind of sounds like a standoff, don't it? Excuse me.
Hazel's right. Looks like the position's open for a third person. But what about you, Alan? I thought you were going to open up an office in Susanville.
Not by myself. That was just for the two of us. So we could have some time for each other. Doesn't seem to have worked out, does it?
Come on, get warm. Get hot.
What about you? I thought Mr. Griffin was the kind of top industrious client you wanted. Change your mind?
Certainly not. But even if I have, that's a woman's prerogative.
Well, I thought we were talking lawyer to lawyer, not man to woman.
Well, if you don't know the difference between a lawyer and a woman, I don't think I'd care to open an office with you in Susanville.
Well, I thought Susanville was out.
And I thought, as a lawyer, you knew how to persuade people around your way of thinking.
Boy, you better not get any of this on me. If Mr. Griffin gets a whiff of this, he'll be getting fancy ideas.
Our family back for five generations.
That's very impressive, Deirdre.
Hi, Miss Thompson.
Hello, Hazel.
What's that, Aunt Deirdre?
That's our family tree, something you should be very proud of, Harold.
What's a family tree?
I'll explain it to you when you're older, Harold.
Dorothy, he's quite old enough to begin to learn the importance of family. You see, Harold, on this chart, you can trace the family all the way back to your great-great-grandfather.
Oh, is there anybody on it I know?
Of course. Here's your father, George Baxter, married Dorothy Webster.
No, he didn't. He married Dorothy Baxter.
Webster was my name before we were married, Harold.
Oh.
Here's someone else you know.
Hey, that's me, Harold Baxter.
That's right. Here's your cousin Nancy, your Uncle Harry. And here I am. Now, do you know what a family tree is?
It's everybody in the family.
That's right. You see, Dorothy, he's not too young to understand.
If it's everybody in the family, how come they left out Hazel?
Beautiful dreamer, wake unto me. La da da dee da 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 da. Oh, help! There's a ferocious giant out here.
And I'm going to eat you up.
Oh, I wouldn't do that if I was you. I'm afraid I'd be kind of stringy. Why don't you have one of these cookies instead? Fresh made this morning.
I'd better have two. I'm a pretty big giant.
Well, all right, but no more, because even giants get holes in their teeth from too many sweets.
Is Dad home? I want to see if I'm as big as he is.
No, he's at the country club having lunch with your Aunt Deidre. Oh, speaking of your dad, what are you going to give him on Father's Day? You know, it's only a little more than a week off.
The only thing I can think of is a leather bookmark.
Well, you gave one to your mother on Mother's Day.
Yeah, I know it.
Why don't you paint him a picture?
Okay.
Say, who's your tall, handsome friend?
I'm a ferocious giant. Rawr!
Oh, I need a can of paint that's on the highest shelf in my workshop. I certainly wish I could reach it.
I'll bet you I can reach it for you.
Wonderful. I'll be out there in a minute, Harold. You know, since you made him those stilts, he's ignored all his other toys.
Oh, sure. He wanted to take him to bed with him last night.
You know, Hazel, I could use a cup of coffee if you were thinking of putting on a pot.
You read my mind, Missy. I'll bring it out to you.
Thanks, Hazel.
Mother, I've been thinking.
It's just what our country needs. What have you been thinking about, Harold?
About Hazel and how she's always doing swell things for us, like making stilts.
Oh, yes, we owe a lot to Hazel. I don't know how we'd get along without her.
It'd be like trying to get along without you or Dad.
Well, almost.
We have a Mother's Day and a Father's Day. I was wondering, why don't we have a Hazel's Day?
Well, I don't know, Harold. I guess because no one ever thought of it before.
Can we do it?
I don't see why not. It's a wonderful idea. She could sleep late, and we could give her breakfast in bed.
And we can take her out to dinner like Dad and I always take you out on Mother's Day.
Tomorrow's Sunday. We don't have any plans. Let's do it tomorrow.
Oh, boy, won't she be surprised.
Oh, I think we better tell her ahead of time.
What for?
Well, so she can look forward to it. You know, the way you look forward to Christmas and to your birthday.
Yeah, but sometimes I just can't stand to wait another day.
Well, Hazel only has to wait one day.
Here she comes. Can I tell her?
Your idea.
Hazel, guess what day tomorrow is?
I don't know, sport. To me, it's just plain old Sunday.
No, it's not. It's Hazel's day.
What are you talking about?
Like Mother's Day and Father's Day, it's going to be Hazel's day.
Oh, for Pete's sake. Here's your coffee, Missy.
You may not be taking this seriously, Hazel, but we are. You're going to have breakfast in bed.
And we're going to take you out to dinner.
And we'll wait on your hand and foot all day long.
It was my idea.
Well, I sure appreciate it, sport, but it ain't necessary.
Well, Mother's Day and Father's Day aren't necessary either.
But, Missy, I'm just your maid.
You're our Hazel, and tomorrow's your day, and that's final.
So you can start looking forward to it. You only have to wait one day.
For Pete's sake, you really mean it?
You're darn tootin'.
The part about taking me out to dinner, too?
Oh, well, that's the most important part.
That was my idea, too.
The cat's got my tongue. I don't know what to say.
Oh, you don't have to say anything.
Well, I know what I gotta do. I gotta get me some new duds. If it's Hazel's day, I can't go out in that old flowered print, for Pete's sake.
Would you like me to go shopping with you?
Oh, I sure would, Missy. You got such terrific taste. I ain't got much in the sock, but I'm gonna blow it off.
You know what, Hazel?
No, what, sport?
You're a doozy.
Do you mean to say you've never heard of Judge Farley?
Deirdre, the legal woods are full of judges.
Well, he's only the chief judge of a United States District Court.
Oh, that Judge Farley. Well, yes, he's handed down some very important decisions.
Harry and I knew him socially when we lived in Boston. And you mark my words, George, he's headed for the Supreme Court of the United States.
I certainly would like to meet him.
He's in town. He's coming to our house for dinner tomorrow. Can you and Dorothy make it?
Well, I don't see why not. We have no other plans.
Good. Oh, you'll like him, George. He's terribly dignified. He belongs to Phi Beta Kappa. And that's one of the better fraternities, you know.
Phi Beta Kappa is not a social fraternity. You're asked to join because of academic excellence.
Oh. Well, I told you he was brainy.
What time is dinner?
8 o'clock. And we'll dress, if you don't mind.
Well, I'm not exactly wild about getting into my tuxedo. Suppose I did mind.
It wouldn't make the slightest difference, George. We're dressing.
Just testing to see if you're still the same old easygoing Deirdre.
All right, Dorothy. I agree with you. Hazel's day is a good idea.
I'm glad you agree.
But don't you agree it's also a good idea for me to be the judge who's on his way up to the Supreme Court?
Yes, I agree.
Well, then, why can't we have Hazel's Day next Sunday?
Well, you're the boss, darling. If that's your decision, that's what we'll do.
All right. That's my decision.
And I think it's very unselfish of you to give up Father's Day.
Who said anything about giving up Father's Day?
Well, it was supposed to be a week from next Sunday.
Oh. Gee, you know what a kick Harold gets out of Father's Day. I'd sure hate to disappoint him. Why, he's probably gone out and made me a nice present. Dorothy, you trapped me.
Oh, darling, I just complimented you on being so unselfish.
Oh, the treachery of the helpless sex. All right, what about the Sunday after?
That's our anniversary, George, and I've already picked out your present. And the weekend after that, your cousin's coming to visit.
I'm surrounded.
Of course, we could forget about Hazel's Day altogether. If you think it's more important to accommodate Deirdre than to meet a total stranger, it's your decision, George.
Some decision. All right, Miss Machiavelli, tomorrow is Hazel's Day. At least I won't have to wear my tuxedo.
Oh, thank you, darling.
You're welcome. Mm-hmm. You know, I'm not looking forward to breaking this news to Deirdre.
Why don't you call her right now and get it over with?
Oh, no, I'll go over and tell her later. It's easier on the eardrums. That sister of mine can really slam down a telephone.
I wonder who that is.
Let's go and see.
Mitch!
Hi, Hazel! What'd he say, Harold?
You got it. Your new cab, huh?
Ain't she a beauty?
She sure is. She's gorgeous.
Oh, I'll say it is. Hi, folks.
Hello, Mitch.
Hi, Mitch. How you like my new buggy?
Oh, that's the best-looking taxi cab I've ever seen.
Well, thank you, Miss Baxter.
Oh, it's just Danny, Mitch.
Well, that's awful nice of you to say so, Mr. Baxter.
Well, you're going to take me for a ride.
Tomorrow night on our date.
Tomorrow night? Oh, I...
Hey, Mitch, you have a date with Hazel tomorrow night?
Sure. I'm taking her out to supper, and then we're going to go roller skating. I want to show off my figure eight.
Hazel, you can't go with Mitch tomorrow night. We're taking you out to dinner.
Oh, well, sport, when a friend has a date with another friend, especially a good friend like Mitch here, you got to keep it no matter what happens.
That's a very commendable attitude, Hazel, and I certainly admire you for it.
But it's Hazel's day.
What's Hazel's day?
Like Mother's Day and Father's Day, but it's Hazel's day, and we're having it tomorrow.
Oh, that sounds like a big day, and I sure wouldn't want to snarl up the gears.
Hey, I know what we can do.
What's that, Harold?
We can take Mitch out to dinner, too. Then Hazel won't have to break her date with him. And Dad can keep on admiring her. Can we, Dad, please?
Well,
it's entirely up to you, darling.
Well, all right, Mitch. Would you care to go to dinner with us tomorrow night?
Oh, I'd consider it a real privilege, Mr. Baxter.
Hot dog. Then it's all settled. You come by around 7.
Gotcha. Say, I got an uncle who's got a tux. I bet she'd make me a loan of it.
No, Mitch, look, it won't be you.
Imagine me going on a date with a fellow with a tux. Boy, I can hardly believe it.
Well, I'll see all you nice folks at 7 o'clock tomorrow night.
You know something, Mr. B? I think tomorrow's going to be the spiffiest day of my whole life.
Hazel, shall we go over and browse through the hats while they wrap your dress?
Sure, why not? Gee, I hope they wrap that dress real careful. Missy, will you look at that hat?
It's lovely.
Oh, will you look at the price? You try it on, Missy. It don't cost nothing.
Oh, you discovered it. You try it on.
Oh, you mean it?
Go ahead. Oh, Hazel, you're a vision. An absolute vision.
Oh, you're kidding.
Oh, go ahead. Look for yourself.
Wow! Oh. Who do I think I am? Princess Grace?
Here's your dress, Hazel.
Oh, thanks, Miss Henry.
Have a lovely time tomorrow.
Thanks. Gee, I just hope Mr. B don't get in no trouble over Hazel's day with the Boston Bean.
Oh, don't you worry about that. George knows how to handle his sister.
You're not serious.
No. Oh, no, you're teasing. Oh, George, you're always teasing me. You've been doing it ever since we were children.
Deirdre, I am not teasing. Tomorrow is Hazel's day.
I don't believe it. It's too fantastic.
Well, I don't think it's so fantastic. After all, we owe a lot to Hazel.
And what do you owe to your sister?
Deirdre, you're being difficult.
I'm being difficult.
Yes, you are.
I'll ignore that. George,
You may not realize it, but Judge Farley doesn't accept dinner invitations from just anyone. You're passing up a rare opportunity that may not come soon again.
All right. All right, Deirdre. If you really want me to meet him tomorrow, there is a way.
Well, that's my only desire. What's the way?
Very simple. We'll all go out to dinner together.
George Baxter, are you out of your mind?
Well, there are several women in my life who are heading me in that direction.
Judge Farley is one of the most distinguished men in our country today, and you're asking him to sit down to dinner with a maid and a cab driver?
Oh, he's not just a driver. Well, he's a dispatcher, and he owns a company. Besides, he's going to wear his uncle's tuxedo.
His uncle's tuxedo? George Baxter, there are times I suspect you're not a Baxter at all. You're a foundling.
Well, there are times I wish that were true.
You'll excuse me. I find this terribly upsetting.
Oh, Deirdre, now, are you really angry?
I'm about as angry with you as I've ever been in my whole life. And I warn you, don't expect any favors from me in the future.
Afraid breakfast wasn't up to your usual.
That was the best breakfast I ever ate. I felt like a queen having breakfast in bed.
Then let's do it every year on Hazel's day, okay, Mother?
All right.
Why don't you go and get Hazel's present now,
huh? Okay.
You got me a present, too?
Oh, just a little bauble.
Animal, vegetable, or a mineral?
Happy Hazel's day.
Oh, thanks, Bud.
Read the card.
To Princess Grace from her devoted serfs, Missy, Mr. B, and Harold.
Aren't you going to open it? Hazel, you're crying.
That's because I'm so happy.
That's the way women are sometimes, son. And there's no point in any mere man trying to understand it.
Oh, Mr. B. Missy, you're giving me this hat is just the difference between living life and just walking around in it. You like it, Mr. B?
Hazel, if this were Easter, you'd be the grandest lady in the parade.
I know it's sinful to want to go to church just to show off your clothes, but boy, I just can't wait for them bells to start ringing.
Good morning, Dr.
Carroll.
Good morning, sir.
Harold.
Hi, Reverend.
Hello, Hazel.
Boy, that was a rip snorter of a sermon you preached this morning.
Oh, thank you, Hazel. That's a rip snorter of a hat.
We gave it to her.
Maybe to you it's just another working day, but to me it's Hazel's day.
Like Mother's Day or Father's Day?
It was my idea.
And a very fine idea indeed, Harold.
Say, Reverend, you remember that swell quote you used from the old Greek, the one about forgiveness?
Forgiveness is better than punishment. For the one is proof of a gentle and the other a savage nature.
Ain't that nice?
Even though I still think you were in the wrong, because of Dr. Carroll's sermon, I'm going to forgive you.
Well, Deirdre, I'm very glad to hear that.
Well, you know, George, basically I've always been a gentle person. George Baxter, you are the most impossible man I've ever been related to.
And in this picture, Mary Sterling saying to her niece, "Now, honey, just because Roger, your fiancé, turned out to be an embezzling bigamist wanted in 5 states who left you waiting at the church, is no reason to be upset." And the niece says to Mary Sterling, sob, "I can't help it, Auntie," sob, "my life is over. Where will I ever find another man like Roger?" Sob, sob. Boy, I don't know why they call these the funnies. They should be calling them the saddies.
Hello, Baxter Residence. Yes, she's here. Just a minute. It's for you, Hazel, and Deidre's maid.
Oh, thanks, Harold. Hazel speaking. Well, hello, Mamie.
Tell me, what's so terrible about having a hat like somebody else's anyway? Men do it all the time.
hat is simply something to cover your head.
Not for a woman, it isn't, Mr. Man.
Well, I'll never understand it. And I'll bet Albert Einstein didn't understand it either.
I bet he didn't work himself into a stew trying to. Why don't you just forget it, darling?
All right. What time are the Sunshine Girls coming over for tea?
Oh, not till 5.
Good. How would you like to go over the driving range with me while I hit a bucket of balls?
Oh, I'd love to, darling, but I have to make those little sandwiches. Hazel, what's the matter?
Oh, I don't feel so good. I think I'll go in my room and lay down.
What happened?
I guess I was a little too greedy with them bum-bums.
Is there anything I can do for you?
Mitch's number's in the book over there. Would you call him for me and cancel our dinner date?
But, Hazel, taking you out to dinner's the most important part of the day.
Missy, the way I feel now, I won't be eating nothing fancier than milk toast till round about Wednesday.
I'm awfully sorry Hazel isn't feeling well, but since she isn't, how do you feel about having dinner with Deidre?
Well, I'm not wildly enthusiastic about it, but I guess there's no reason why we shouldn't.
Well, shall I call her?
I suppose.
Where's Hazel?
She's in her room.
Aunt Deidre's maid said something on the telephone that made her sad, and she wouldn't tell me what it was.
Oh, Hazel had a telephone call from Mamie? That's very interesting.
Hello, Deidre. Why'd you do that?
I think Hazel's bluffing. Hazel, I want to talk to you.
What about?
Your fake stomach ache. What did Mamie call you about?
Oh, she just wanted to get a recipe for my Yorkshire pudding.
Harold tells me she told you something that made you very unhappy. Now, what was it?
No, it was nothing.
Come on, Hazel, out with it. And that's an order.
Well, she said on account of Hazel's day, you wasn't getting to meet a very important judge.
That's my decision.
And she also said on account of Hazel's day that you and your sister wasn't speaking. And, Mr. B, I don't want to be the cause of no trouble between brother and sister.
Hazel, you are not the cause of the trouble. It's Deirdre's attitude. So now that your stomach ache seems to be better, where do you want to go?
No, Mr. B, I think you should have dinner with your sister and talk things over.
We're having dinner with you and Mitch.
The master has spoken, Hazel.
So, where will it be?
Well, if you really think it's all right, could we go someplace where there's dancing?
Of course.
'Cause Mitch is a whale of a dancer.
To Hazel, one of the nicest and prettiest ladies I ever hoped to know.
Oh, Mitch, for Pete's sake.
To Hazel.
To Hazel. If anyone wants to know what day I'd like to live over, I certainly have the answer already.
Hazel, they're playing at Charleston. Come on, let's get up and show them our stuff.
You know, Judge, I can't get over how inconsiderate Mamie's daughter Louise was, deciding to have her baby before Mamie had the roast on.
I don't really think she did it on purpose.
Shall I check your rap, dear?
Please, Harry. And see if you can get a good table.
Yes, dear.
Sake.
What's the matter, George?
Deirdre.
Well, it's so crowded, George, maybe you won't lock horns.
You know, Judge, it isn't every day that I get to be seen in public with a man of your importance.
And it isn't every day I'm exposed to a lady who thinks I'm so much more important than I am.
The great ones are always modest.
Could you excuse me a minute? I think I see someone I know.
Of course. Don't stay away too long.
Mind if I cut in?
Well, I'm...
Hazel Burke, PS3.
Clem Farley! Well, where have you been all these years?
Oh, darling, it's wonderful to see you. Ah!
trouble?
Harry, I'm afraid I'm terribly ill. Hallucinations. I just imagined I saw Judge Farley embracing Hazel.
No, no, dear. You'll be all right. It is a bit stuffy in here.
That looks like the man who came in with Deirdre and Harry. You don't suppose... Oh, no, that couldn't be Judge Farley. It's impossible.
Harry, I am having hallucinations. Now they're doing the Charleston.
Oh, this has been the most wonderful day of my life. I just want to thank everybody.
Believe me, Hazel, it was our pleasure.
And it was my idea.
I'm so glad everybody's friends again.
Excuse me, aren't you Judge Farley?
Well, I should say he is.
You're Don Chutin, and he's headed for the Supreme Court of the whole United States.
I wonder if I might take your picture for our local paper.
Why, certainly.
Hot dogs, crunch in, everybody.
Thank you.
Be sure and send me a copy. Well, back to being a pumpkin.
হ্যালো গাইস, আপনারা সবাই কেমন আছেন? আশা করি ভালোই আছেন। আপনাদের দয়ে আমিও ভালো আছি। আজ অনেকদিন পর আপনাদের কাছে নতুন একটি ভিডিও নিয়ে আসলাম। তো এই ভিডিওতে আমি একটি বিস্কুট নিয়ে আলোচনা করব। এই বিস্কুটটি আমি কিনেছি মাত্র 10 টাকা দিয়ে। তো এই বিস্কুটের নাম হচ্ছে চোকোফান বিস্কুট। এটি হলো চকলেট বিস্কুট এবং এটি লেখা এখানে উল্লেখ আছে যে এটি একটি স্যান্ডউইচ ক্রিম বিস্কুট, কারণ এটি সে দুটি বিস্কুট ক্রিম দিয়ে যুক্ত থাকে। এটি একটি খুবই মজার বিস্কুট। এটির এখানে উৎপাদন এবং উৎপাদন মেয়াদ মূল্য এবং এখানে যে কোম্পানির বিভিন্ন কোড থাকে সেই কোড এবং এটির নিট ওজন দেওয়া হয়েছে। এটি নিট ওজন হচ্ছে 38 গ্রাম। তো এটি এই প্যাকেটটি আগে আরও বড় ছিল, কিন্তু এখন দ্রব্যমূল্যের ঊর্ধ্বগতি হওয়ায় এখানে এটির দায় একটা প্যাকেট ছোট করে এটির দাম একই রাখা হয়েছে এবং প্যাকেট ছোট করে ফেলা হয়েছে। এই যখন এটি নতুন বের হয় তখন এটি ছিল প্রায় অনেকটাই লম্বা এবং অনেকগুলো বিস্কুট ছিল, কিন্তু এখন যেহেতু বাংলাদেশে বিভিন্ন পণ্যের দাম বেড়ে গিয়েছে তাই এটির দাম ঠিক রেখে এটি বিস্কুট কমিয়ে দেওয়া হয়েছে এবং এটি তৈরি ছোট করে ফেলা হয়েছে। তো এখানে বিস্কুটটিতে রয়েছে বিস্কুটটির উপাদান সমূহ এখানে উল্লেখ করা আছে। তো এখানে উপাদান সমূহ লেখা হয়েছে যে এটি ময়দা, চিনি, ভোজ্য তেল, ফ্যাটাস, দুধ এবং দুগ্ধজাত পণ্য দিয়ে তৈরি করা হয়েছে। তো এটি আমি আপনাদের মাঝে আজকে ছিঁড়ে খাওয়াবো, খেয়ে দেখাবো, পারলে আপনাদেরকে খাওয়াতাম। তো এই প্যাকেটটি আমি আস্তে আস্তে ছিঁড়লাম। ছিঁড়ার পর এখানে অনেকগুলো বিস্কুট দেখা যাচ্ছে। এখানে প্রায় একটি বিস্কুট হচ্ছে এরকম সাইজের একটি বিস্কুট পাবেন আপনারা। তো এটি হচ্ছে দুইটি ভাগে বিভক্ত, যেমন এখানে ক্রিম দিয়ে, এটা হচ্ছে ক্রিম এবং এটা ক্রিম দিয়ে দুইটি বিস্কুট যুক্ত। তো এটি আমি খেয়ে দেখব। ও গাইস, এটি অনেক মজার। আপনারা যদি চান তাহলে এটি খেয়ে দেখতে পারেন এবং এটি খুবই ভালো একটি বিস্কুট, ভালো মনে একটি বিস্কুট। আপনারা চাইলে এটি খুবই কম দামে কিনে নিতে পারবেন, যেমন এটির দাম হচ্ছে 10 টাকা। এটি একটি মিনি প্যাক, আপনারা চাইলে বড় প্যাকও কিনতে পারবেন। বড় প্যাকের দাম সর্বোচ্চ হলে 60 টাকা হতে পারে। আপনারা ছোট প্যাক একটু ট্রাই করে বড় প্যাকটি কিনতে পারেন, কারণ এটি হচ্ছে খুবই একটি মজার একটি বিস্কুট। যেহেতু ক্রিম দেওয়া হয়েছে বিস্কুটটিতে তাই এটি খেতেও খুব মজা। এখন ক্রিমযুক্ত বিস্কুটটি খেয়ে নিলাম। ও, এটি তো অনেক মজার। আপনারা চাইলে এটি খেতে পারেন এবং এটি খুবই মজার একটি বিস্কুট। যে বিস্কুটটি প্রায় 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 ষাটটি একটি আমি খেয়ে নিলাম। এটি হচ্ছে 60 বিস্কুট পাওয়া যাবে। 60 বিস্কুট যেহেতু দুইটা করে যুক্ত আর একটা সাথে একটা মানে ক্রিম দা দুইটার মতো তাই 14, কারণ 14টি বিস্কুট আপনারা পাবেন। আপনারা খেয়ে দেখতে পারেন, এটি খুবই মজার একটি বিস্কুট, অনেক মজার। আপনারা চাইলে এটি খেতে পারেন এবং এটি খুব ভালো, যেহেতু এটি এই রিদিশা ব্র্যান্ডের একটি বিস্কুটের প্যাকেট। রিদিশা ব্র্যান্ডটি খুব ভালো হয়, এই বিস্কুটটি আপনি স্বাস্থ্যসম্মত এবং খুবই ভালো।